Oh my God, hello.
Hi, Tim. How are you today? Tym Moss.
And Wendy Stuart. Yay.
If you're watching If These Walls Could Talk. And today, Tim and I are in separate locations.
I miss you.
And Tim is in?
I'm at home in Washington Heights. Yes, and I miss you.
I miss you, Tim. Listen, you know, every week we have our pandemic pillow separating us. So I need to have a hug moment. it's like having Tim next to me, but it's safer, I guess. Well, yes. Whatever.
Yes, welcome to If These Walls Could Talk. And the reason that we have split screens this week is I leave right after this to go get my second vaccination shot.
Yay,
I'm going to be fully vaxxed.
Oh, boy. Vaxxed and relaxed, as I like to say.
Yes.
So I just got back from Florida, Tim. I needed a little R&R, and mm-hmm. I really felt like, I told you, I risked my life getting on that plane. I flew United Airlines. It's really United, but I felt ignited on it. Boy, they were packing them in. Every row. Of course, I had the row that didn't recline. It was just so weird flying during this pandemic. Yeah. But you know, hopefully more people will get vaccinated. Everybody out there who's listening, really important to do. We got to get control of this thing. Mm-hmm. We have to find our normalcy, right?
Yep, absolutely, absolutely.
Oh, and oh my God, talking about normal, our guest today. She's so
I was just gonna say. I love your shirt.
This shirt. Well, you might recognize the bodacious, bawdy blonde on my shirt. We're very excited to have her. She is the grand dame of drag. She is legend. She has a new show on Hulu. She's living for it. She's got over 19 million views on all of her parodies. And I always say, I have never met a harder working professional than the one and only Sherry Vine.
Yay. Oh my God, I adore both of you.
Oh my God, thank you so much for saying that. Love you forever.
We have known each other for, I know, Wendy, you and I have known each other since. From the beginning. Sweetie, you and Sweetie worked together, right?
Yes, and right. And Sweetie and I met in New York City in an improv class when Sweetie wore khaki pants and a plaid shirt and had a girlfriend named Rhonda back in Michigan. Girl, we're going way back on that one.
I've known you at least 25 years.
I think even maybe longer. And I was telling Tim, one of the things I never forgot, I had a huge birthday party. Well, I have a huge birthday party all the time, but this was like 10 years ago. And we had a major blizzard. And I had a number of drag performers booked to show up with blonde hair to look like me, right? Everybody begged it because it was like a legendary blizzard that we had in New York and people couldn't make it. All of my guests showed, and the only drag artist who came that night was you, Sherry Vine, and I never forgot it.
Well, you know, honey, nothing's going to keep me. There's no blizzard that's going to keep me from a cocktail and potentially meeting a straight man who's blind in one eye who needs service.
Yeah, there you go. Because she did, right. Right. That's what I love about you. You take risks in your life.
I do.
Speaking of risks, I went to your goodbye dinner given by Stephen Chirac, and I had never seen you out of drag. And this is really funny. When I walked in and I sat down and I was talking to you, I didn't know it was you, right? This was this Keith person. And I said, when is Sherry getting here? You probably don't even remember this because it was so crazy. And you said, I'm Sherry. And I was like,
I was so shocked that it was like, we've known each other for so long and you had not seen me out of drag.
I live in a beautiful bubble here, Sherry. My drag friends, I only see in drag. I only know them by their drag. You know what? It's a beautiful thing. So let's talk about your move to LA. Quite frankly, I was shocked. Yes. You did it. You jumped off the ledge. What was the problem?
So tell us, how do you like LA?
Yeah.
Well, you know, it was kind of like a full circle because I lived here. I went to college here.
Oh, I didn't know that.
I got my master's degree in theater at USC in the late 80s. And so I lived in LA, and everyone was shocked when I moved to New York because growing up as a kid, the only thing I talked about was getting to Los Angeles because I was going to be a movie star. That's literally, that was my plan since I was 3 years old. I got into USC, I moved here, I was auditioning and doing commercials and doing theater, and I was like, I'm on the path that I've wanted to be on since I was three. And then I started performing in drag for fun and just felt like a calling.
Wow.
My friends from Baltimore, where I grew up, had moved to New York to go to theater school. They were like, we're going to start a theater company. We need you to play the mother. And I'm like, okay. And I ended up, it turned into a career. And so my parents were not, they were more shocked that I was leaving Los Angeles than I was doing drag.
I love you. I saw a picture of you with your dad. You had put some amazing. I love that you have those kind of parents.
They're amazing. And so, yeah, I was like, I'm going to move to New York and do drag. And they're like, you're moving to New York?
Yeah.
The drag wasn't even an issue. So everybody's shocked. Anyway, for the past like 6 years, I've been threatening to move here since Jackie Beat and I started doing the Golden Girlz and all these other things. We had some plans of things we wanted to do. And I was coming back and forth constantly. And I kept saying, I'm going to move here. And they're like, you're never going to move here. And then when I got started really getting the wheels spinning on my new show, the Sherry Vine Variety Show, which we'll talk about. It's coming to Out TV. Jacob from PEG was like, this would be so much easier if you lived here. And I was like, that was literally the little push that I need. I'm like, I'm moving to LA.
Yeah.
And so I moved here. We got the green light to do the show. The pandemic happened. Everything kind of like at one time. But I am so happy here. I miss New York. I fucking love New York City. I was there for 28 years. Wow. It was just time to do something different.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And I am so happy.
Well, and also you were saying you just moved there and the pandemic hits. And I mean, what a difference.
Wow.
Of your home.
Oh my God. Let me tell you, I was so blessed. And I've said this many times, but I'm being sincere. I, as much as I love New York, you know, I lived in a room.
Right.
And the kitchen was such a piece of crap that I never cooked. I never cooked. I would order food and I'd sit on my bed in my bedroom.
Uh-huh.
And in front of the TV. So I like ate on my bed.
Welcome to my world.
New York. Yep.
That's New York.
New York. Look, I have a kitchen. I know, you know.
You've got a great kitchen because I watch your cooking show.
Right, that's so funny, and I never cook.
You never cook.
And now I'm here. I moved into when I came here to LA, at first I was staying with Jackie Beat. And I was looking for an apartment. I really wanted to be in the city, like as close to downtown, but not downtown. It's still a little sketchy. But I was looking, and my friend Mario Diaz, who started The Cock in New York City, and he's
Mario Diaz.
We all love Mario. Mario, like, you should come and live with me. My roommate's leaving in Burbank. And I was like, girl, I didn't move to LA to live in Burbank. And he's like, just come and look at it. So I was like, okay. I came out and I saw this house, 2-bedroom, 2-bath, a pool, a yard, and a garage. And he's like, we will turn the garage into a walk-in closet.
Get out!
And get this, I'm paying less than I did for the room in New York.
Oh my God.
Of course. I have
my own bedroom, my own bathroom.
Oh, how wonderful.
Huge, gorgeous house, this huge kitchen that I now cook in. It's the first time all my drag is hanging, all the wigs.
Beautiful, right?
It's really cool. I'm so spoiled now. And the pool, so to be here during the pandemic and just be like, I feel guilty that I'm sitting out by the pool with my friends socially distancing.
Yeah, right.
instead of like sitting in the room staring at the wall in New York. So
anyway, you know, but eating, good eating. For you, Sherry, that you, you know what, you took that leap of faith. Uh-huh. And you did say something that was very important for performers. You did have things set up before you went there. You didn't just go to see what was going to happen. You know, you're a brand. People know who you are. You already have the wheels moving. You laid the groundwork. So why not, right? Why not do it?
Yeah. And everything that I kind of wanted to happen here is happening. So I'm very lucky.
I love that. I love that so much.
And I have friends here that are family. Jackie,
yeah, Martin, right, right.
Candace Payne. I mean, there's so many friends here that I've known for 30 years or more.
Well, Bianca's out there now, isn't she? Bianca's out there now. Bianca Del
Rio. Bianca's out here. Yeah. Yes, I see Bianca a lot. She lives in Palm Springs. And
oh, I didn't know that.
Uh-huh. Yeah, and you're doing a show together. The two of you have been doing, I watched something on.
We have a podcast that we do in stereo. Called the BS show, BS bullshit. BS, yeah. But yes, this was, she moved into a house in Palm Springs in March. So right at the beginning of the pandemic. And she's very isolated. She wasn't seeing anyone. And so I would go out like once a month and stay for like 2 or 3 days.
Nice.
And out. So it was really fun.
Yeah, I love hearing like all this great news. Now I have a question for you. You just kind of came upon drag from what you said, right? You know, you had studied acting, but you came upon drag. When you were little Sherry Vine, did you ever think about, you know, that you loved you, that you were attracted? I was attracted to the drag world. I kid you not, from the time I was yay high. Wigs, feathers, way too much makeup, lashes from the time I was a little kid. I'm curious about you. Were you attracted to that?
Yes, but it wasn't just that. I mean, I remember being really young watching Carol Burnett, who's obviously my biggest influence, my biggest icon. I worship her.
What, love her.
I loved the Sonny and Cher show, and I was obsessed with Cher. So I was obsessed with the look and the costumes, but I was also obsessed with the different characters that they played. So Carol Burnett to me was like it was something about her physical comedy that I was inspired by. And when I would play, like as a little kid, we would play, you know, house and different things. I mean, one day I'd be like, I'm going to be the mother. The next day I'm going to be like, I'm going to be the policeman. So it wasn't really about gender. I didn't always have to be the heteronormative.
Right. It was about characters, being a character.
And so it was all just kind of like dressing up in costume was nothing. That was just part of it.
Yeah.
So you used to just taking on the
drag. Yeah. And the drag part really came out of in college, I would read like A Streetcar Named Desire and I'd be like, I want to be Blanche.
Everybody wants to be Blanche.
Right, right.
Look, there was no way I was ever going to be cast as Stanley. Never. I'm out of drag. You know, I'm a character. I'm not a leading man. Like, I was never going to be Stanley. So I'm like, I want to be Blanche. That's the fun part.
Right.
That's when I started experimenting with drag, because it's like, I want to be Blanche. I want to be Hedda Gabler. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, the thing is, with your drag, you have such a distinctive persona, such a distinctive look. And it's
I think I do now. I didn't start off this way. I mean, I send photos. It's just like, I definitely, in the beginning of performing as Sherry Vine, thought I had to look funny. If I was going to be a comedy queen. And I was hanging out with Candace and Lena and Formica. And I was like,
oh my God.
They're all so pretty. And I started performing at Boy Bar. And the look just kind of evolved. And I was like, I want to be the slutty sex kitten. And still be funny. And I mean, sometimes I look at other drag queens like Jackie Beat, who always looks different. But always looks like her. And I'm like, I wish I was a bit more like that. And the honest truth is, I know how to do this makeup, and that is it. And anytime I try to do something different,
right,
it's a mess, or it just always ends up looking like this. Like, this is all I can do. And I remember performing in Barcelona one summer when I was there for the whole summer, and a really good friend of mine, Aroba, a drag queen there, was like, you're always blonde and you're always kind of look kind of the same. And don't you ever want to just put on red hair or, you know, different makeup or whatever? And I'm like, I want to walk into a bar and have people know who I am.
Yeah.
Yes.
And that's exactly what you do.
Yeah. Right. You definitely have a thing about staying on brand, which is like being true to yourself. And that is something you really need to be complimented for, because this is the next thing I want to talk to you about, how drag, right, in our world has evolved. You were one of the first drag artists that I met that actually sang. Everybody else I know, you know, Sweetie was an unbelievable lip syncer.
Sweetie, absolute best.
Yeah.
But you sang, and it was something that was new for New York, you know? To have a drag performer saying, what, from your perception, have you noticed how things have evolved? And then with that, talk about, like, I'm going to bring it up, RuPaul's Drag Race, because that has affected things.
I want to get your opinion on that, but you go ahead with this first.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, when I first started Sherry, the reason why I created Sherry Vine really was because I was doing a play here in Los Angeles. Where this woman, Robin Sky, sang Black Coffee, the Torch song, Black Coffee.
Uh-huh.
And I had done drag just to kind of go out and for fun, but I didn't have the character Sherry Vine. And I wanted to sing that song. And I was like, no one wants to see some skinny gay boy sing this song. And I didn't really I didn't know how to sell it. And I was like, I'm going to do like this kind of broken down show girl named Sherry, who sings this Torch song. And it started off as kind of funny comedy. And definitely in LA, the only person I had ever seen sing live in drag in LA was Vaginal Cream Davis. And she did like rock and roll.
I love the name. I don't even know who that is.
She was the first drag queen I ever saw, and it blew my mind because she was so kind of punk rock, the antithesis of West Hollywood drag at that time. And that's when I was like, oh, I'm going to do that. And that's how it started. Mm-hmm. And so I was like, I'm going to sing live. I'm not going to lip sync. That was part of it. And nothing wrong with lip syncing at all. It's just like, I want to do comedy and parodies. Mm-hmm. So I have to sing live. And went to New York. And certainly like Joey Arias, John Kelly, there live. But yeah, it was kind of this renaissance. I moved to New York in 1992, and it was like that was the year. Well, Sweetie and Faux Pas were new, and Chiquita. They had all been around 1 year, but that 92 is like Varla, Head of Lettuce, me, Formica, Candace, Lena, like a whole list that people that are still performing. So it was really this exciting time.
Right. Well, very exciting time.
You're watching If These Walls Could Talk with your host, Wendy Stuart and Tym Moss, and our exceptional and fabulous guest today, the wonderful Sherry Vine.
Yay!
Just real quick before I jump back into that, Ike Avelli says, I really miss the days when Sherry would DJ at Michael for Micah Jones' party opening in New York City way back.
Way back. No, we have to use the term DJ very loosely. I was a terrible DJ. I mean, I think I had very good taste in music and people loved it. But oh my God, I would like, first of all, I have so much respect for DJs because it takes incredible focus. And what my problem was is I put a song on and start talking to somebody and then it'd be over. And it'd be like dead silence. I'm like, oh shit, sorry, hold on. Like that would happen constantly.
You'd rather talk to people. You know, your whole thing is about talking to your audience, talking to people.
Yeah, I decided I needed to DJ because I just don't have the focus. And I was like, okay, I'm good at I like the, Johnny Dinell, the legendary.
Oh, he's so good.
Johnny Dinell came up to me one night and he was like, I don't think you should call yourself a teacher.
But now,
oh my God.
But now, like you were saying a little while ago, going back to when you came to New York and the circle that you embraced, that was the formulation of drag in New York City. Wow. I mean, that was kind of the core group. You were part of the development and evolution.
Yeah,
like
I mean,
you said it was a renaissance of you were setting, you were helping to set the rules of drag, and you studied your craft, and it was it wasn't just putting on a dress and going out and lip syncing a song.
Yeah, I mean, I think the seeds were already planted. Obviously, I mean, there was the chapter before 92 when there was this renaissance. Mm-hmm. The chapter before was like Pyramid, Lady Bunny, Sixth Dimension, Billy Beyond, Patty Hathaway, Lip Synca.
Yes. Oh, I love love Lip Synca.
RuPaul, Mona Foote. So like there's this amazing, but by the time I was starting, they were like the legendary queens of New York.
Oh, already.
Babies. But to be able to kind of like, you know, have really look up to someone and admire someone like Lady Bunny and then have her be like, oh, come and do this and you should be part of Wigstock. Yeah. It was really, really great.
How
that
incredible.
Kind of like helped everything. So, and then you have the next renaissance chapter where like Varla, all these queens, Shaquita, everyone's doing things that were maybe a little bit more coming from theater as opposed to performance art. So it was just kind of different. And I loved how these roads all merged together. I mean, Joey Arias already was like legendary. Yeah.
Right.
It's amazing. Transcends
love everything.
Because that is a brilliant, brilliant performer. And I have to wonder if a lot of the drag that so many talented drag queens have come out of RuPaul's Drag Race, but there's so many of them. And I wonder if it's going to be like wham, bam, thank you, ma'am. Whereas people like Joey Arias, you know what I'm saying? That is unbelievable. Joey's been around, so talented and, you know, so powerful still. I wanted to ask you something. You came here, I know, in the early 90s. New York was gutted by AIDS. I was a very big part. We had an AIDS organization that we were very involved in. I lost 2 phone books of people. And by the early 90s, I was so messed up. Sweetie was, you know, why don't you come to Cheese Whiz? Come to Boy Bar, come to Pyramid. I was even tepid to go out. How did you feel coming into drag at that time when so many people, everything was like all mixed up and New York like had a moratorium going on? You'd walk down Christopher Street, Tim, you could feel it. You could feel the death. So what was that like for you?
Well, it's funny because I was just asked to write something for New York Pride. I think it's like the 40-year anniversary of AIDS, being called AIDS. And I was like, I don't even know. I can't even like sit down to write. I literally can't find the words to express that time. I mean, I was a little bit sheltered. I was just 5 years behind living in New York City or something. You know what I mean? I was in college. I was in this little bubble. And by the time I was out of college, I was 27. And when I started drag, it was a little bit later. And I moved to New York in 92. And I mean, look, my best friend, Douglas, who I started the theater company with, Theater Couture with originally in New York, died in 95. We were roommates. So, and I certainly have a long list of friends also that I lost, but it wasn't like what Joey talks about in the 80s. He's just like, I went to a funeral every week.
Same. Memorials.
It's horrifying.
Yeah, right. And it really impacted a lot of us. I find most of my friends that came here in the early 90s, you came from a bubble, came to New York when AIDS was, it was still here, but they already were finding ways.
Kind of manageable.
Yeah, they were right.
They were trying to be manageable. Right. Like Douglas missed that by literally 8 months.
Oh, my God.
It was like around 95, the end of 95 maybe, or middle where they started the cocktails. So he passed off in January of 95. So he just missed it. But yeah, I remember visiting friends in New York in the hospitals, and they were in the hallway on a bed in the hallway. Yep. There wasn't even room for them. It was it was horrible. And drag was very political when people are like, oh, you know, do you feel like you should be more political? And I'm like, well, first of all, to do drag in the early 90s was an act of political activism.
Yes. Yes.
I had to walk from Avenue C to the pyramid in drag because couldn't get a car or a taxi. Right. I didn't have any money. Mm-hmm. And you took your life into your hands.
Right.
Every time that you left the house in drag.
Right.
I agree.
And in the middle of this pandemic of AIDS, if you can make a room full of people laugh for 5 minutes, that is political.
Right. Yeah.
No, that's all of this is part of what I kind of wanted to touch on. I'm trying to think of how to be politically correct about this. Because see, what I was referring to with you and Varla and Jackie and just everybody is you were so revolutionary.
Yeah.
And so creative and so artistic. You did all of them did things that nobody else had done. And now on RuPaul's Drag Race has brought drag out into national mainstream. Mm-hmm. But these kids that are going on there, really, so many of them have no clue where it came from, just like you were saying, where you could have gotten killed just going from one club to another. You know, they don't realize what you went through so that they can just, oh, I'm going to be on TV now.
Yes. Right.
I mean, it's not that easy, but I get a little aggravated sometimes when they're like,
I get what you're saying, but I think, like, I guess everybody, it depends. That could be said about everyone. I mean, certainly the generation before us, because I think the three of us are at least around the same age. The generation
35.
34. Oh my God, we are. The generation before us who fought at Stonewall and all could certainly say, oh, look, we did this for you. So,
right.
Like, you know, Drag Race, all I want to say about Drag Race is one, I'm a fan. I watch it every season.
Yeah.
I always have friends on it. Two,
same here.
At one point, I really did think that it was going to put the nail in the coffin of my career. I was just like, because I was mostly at that time doing club gigs still and traveling around the world doing club gigs. But all of a sudden, they weren't booking me or Jackie or Varla or Coco. They were booking Drag Race Queen.
Oh, right.
I think maybe we're done. And that's when Jackie and I were like, let's do the Golden Girlz. Let's stop making club gigs the priority and really go back to what we started drag for, which was theater.
Smart.
And let's go back to that. And that's exactly what we did. And now I feel like it's kind of gone full circle again, where there's an appreciation for the elders, Jackie, Varla, Coco, Peru.
Yeah, I love Coco.
All the queens on the show do get that. And Alaska and Willem and Jinx, they want to work with us. They respect us as the elders. And so that's really, really, really cool. And in the end, that show, RuPaul's Drag Race, now has certainly opened doors and made...
Oh, absolutely.
They have legitimized drag as an art form and as a monetary performance. Do you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Before Drag Race, I think people were still like, it's niche. Yeah. It's just for gay men. There's no money to be made. We don't want it in TV or film. And now it's like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
Now it made it okay. I'll tell you something. I remember in your career, Sherry, when you started doing parodies. Okay, because you didn't launch on the drag scene doing parodies.
And I did, actually, but
You know what I'm saying? To the degree where all of a sudden you were everywhere on YouTube. Francis Legg was producing these incredible videos for you. What made you want to take your parodies up a notch and explode them? Because that's exactly what you did. You really became so known because
I have to give, I have to give props, because I honestly, what happened was Jackie Beat was booked for a show like an Oshkosh or something. And I'm like, girl, how the fuck did you get booked there? And she's like, oh, from my YouTube video. And this was the dawn.
I love it.
Yeah.
And Jackie had a lot of success. Jackie and Mila Jam,
Mila,
who was performing under Brittany Houston at the time as a drag queen, they both had viral videos at the very beginning, and I was like, so I have to give props like to them of like being
visionaries. Yeah, but
YouTube was the perfect marriage of what I love: parodies and film.
Yeah,
right.
And I really wanted to be doing short films, and this was like an opportunity to do short film. I mean, because I look at those video parodies, a lot of the ones that some of them are thrown together, farted out on a green screen, but a lot of them were kind of epic and short films.
Yeah.
And so it was the perfect marriage. And then I was given this gift called Lady Gaga.
Right. You have done so many Lady Gaga parodies.
Right. Sherry.
If you're going to do parodies, Lady Gaga is giving you an Easter basket chock full of looks, dancers,
right?
Everything. Like everything. It's like, it was just the perfect timing. And Perez Hilton, it was the peak of Perez Hilton, the beginning of Gaga, the beginning of YouTube. I did the Bad Romance parody. Perez put it up. Gaga put it up on her website. Loved it. And then it just kind of, that's when it kind of like exploded.
Well, you're watching If These Walls Could Talk with your hosts, Wendy Stuart and Tym Moss, and our fabulous, wonderful, glorious guest, Miss Sherry Vine.
Glorious.
And we have been talking about her videos. So why don't we take a quick look at one of your videos right now? How about that?
Oh, this is a newer one. Pandemic parody.
Yes.
Pandemic parody. Perfect for the pandemic, Sherry.
Okay.
And then we'll talk.
More.
Do not stop, just walk by. Yes, it's nice to see you, but from here is fine. I'm sorry, there's no meet and no greet. So stay on your side of the street. It's social distancing. What that means is stay the fuck away from me. One man walked right up to me. He sneezed in my face. Bless you, bitch. Stand back, stand back. I want to be far from you. Do you not watch the news? It's not right, it's not right to be standing by my side. To be standing by my side. I will hide. La 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 la. Do not hug or kiss my face. Do not enter in my space. Can you breathe that air or the bear? Would you walk right up next to me? Do you know the difference between 6 inches and 6 feet? then you start to cough. Not to be rude, my dear, but please back off. Stand back, stand back. I don't want to shake hands, but don't you understand? It's not right to be standing by my side. To be standing by my side, I will hide. La 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 la. La 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 la.
Why so I try to get away from your touch. Keep your corona to yourself. Thank you very much. Say it, don't spray it. You just hit me in the eye with your spit.
Stand back, stand back. I'm gonna escape from them. Don't want to share the plan. It's not right, it's not right. You be standing by my side. You be standing by my side. I will hide. I feel any little germicide. Funny little moist towelette. Funny little sanitizer. You don't need to be standing here.
Stand back!
You don't need to be standing here.
Stand back!
You don't need to be standing here.
Stand back! Please go home. Please go home. Stand back! Why don't you go home?
I need little Windex.
Stand back!
You don't need to be standing here.
Stand back!
Why don't you please go home? Why don't you please go home?
Stand back! Just go home.
Oh my gosh.
So stupid.
So fun.
I love that. I love that you were like, I'm going to pick Stand Back because it's not about poop or penis. And I was like, okay, that's fine.
You know, I try and keep it clean, but of course, I co-host with Tym Moss is about as dirty as they come.
But yeah, because so many of your videos are usually about body functions or body fluids.
Filthy.
They're very down in your videos, you know?
It's filthy. My mom loved that one also. So funny. But yeah, I did a whole bunch of anyone who goes to my YouTube channel, Miss Sherry Vine, can see there's a whole playlist called Pandemic Pop Parodies of the things that I've done in the past year.
And also for anything and everything Sherry Vine, go to her website, sherryvine.com.
Yes.
But oh my God, some of the guests that you've had on your videos in the past. You know, of course, Jackie Beat and Joey Arias and Peppermint was in a few. And yeah. Oh my God, they're always so much fun.
Who is the crew that you had in this video, in the Stand Back video?
That's just me and Mario. We played all the characters.
Okay, so I asked you that question. I had no idea. Oh, that is really fabulous. It's fantastic, really, you know. Oh, yeah.
That was shot in my living room, just me and Mario.
Really great job. Very entertaining. When you say Sherry Vine, it's very entertaining. When this pandemic started, did you freak out at any time thinking, how am I going to make money? I mean, you were doing Atlantis cruises, right? Mm-hmm. Those were huge. All right. You had all these live gigs. So what went through your head?
Well, I mean, yes, but I kept, you know, no one knew it was going to be this long. There were all these false endings.
Right. Yeah, right.
You kind of kept thinking like, okay, I just got to make it to June. By June, the summer, everything's going to be fine. And I had stuff booked, you know, for the summer. And I was like, everything kind of kept getting pushed and pushed. I was like, okay, we just have to make it to September. If we make it to September where everything's fine.
Yep, yep.
So it's really like a lot of folks. But I was lucky. I mean, I did get unemployment and for a time. I'm not now, but I did get unemployment for a time. And I was able to generate some income with
good
online shows.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Venmo.
We turned our living room into a studio.
Nice.
At the end of March. I mean,
I love this.
We ordered lights. We ordered the green screen. We ordered a real microphone and sound system. Calpurnia, who edited and did all the work in that video, came over and set everything up and showed me how to do everything. And so we really, Jackie and I did a bunch of quarantine videos, like the Golden Girlz in quarantine, I Love Lucy in quarantine. And people would tip us. So I was very lucky. I mean, obviously I lost money like everybody did, but it wasn't as bad as it could have.
Right, right.
You not only kept yourself going, but I think the real inspiration here, a lot of people that are creative people shut down. They were buried in this pandemic because it just emotionally, you know, your reaction, Tim, your reaction and my reaction, what mine was, I'm mad as hell. This is bullshit. Okay. I can't cook. I created a cooking show in 36 hours from when they shut New York down because it was unacceptable to me to be told, we're going to take away every way you can earn money. And right. I look at you and what you've done. I've followed you throughout the pandemic, your stellar shows, Sherry, everything that you've done, the videos and all of that. And I'm like, God, I always called you the hardest working woman in show business. I think in this pandemic, you were the hardest working woman in the pandemic. And I got to tell you that.
Well, thank you. That's really sweet. Thank you. And I had a great like group of people to work with. And also, I just had to keep myself entertained. I'm like, what am I going to do? I'm not the type of person to sit around. And even during the pandemic, I was like, okay, I need to really do something. So I really got on a very serious workout regimen and routine.
Routine.
And then I would work on creative stuff, whether it was making a video or writing or something. I would try to work from the minute I get up until like 5 or 6 p.m.
Get out.
And then I'm like, now it's wine time and Jeopardy, and we'll make a little dinner. And that's been my life for the past year.
Yep. Well, once again, you're watching If These Walls Could Talk with your hosts, Wendy Stuart and Tym Moss, and our fabulous and wonderful guest, Sherry Vine.
Yay. I am broadcasting today live from PANGEA Restaurant on 2nd Avenue between 11th and 12th. You know PANGEA, Sherry. They are amazing how they have supported the community
for
years. And now, you know, we want to tell everyone, come and support them.
GoFundMe.
And if they have live entertainment now in the window, which is so cool.
In the window.
That's right, girl. We are performing in windows. We are like the hookers in Amsterdam. You got to do what you got to do. But also the ambiance, it's all set up outside. You can dine inside, outside. Performers in the window.
Great.
And we're all moving forward. Come and support them. They supported us.
Now, just real quick, in some of the comments, I just saw Rich Alseguera. He just said, just look at all these gorgeous blondes.
Yay!
Yes. Now, you had mentioned the Golden Girlz and also your television show. Tell us about what you're doing now.
I love it.
The pandemic was spent working on and getting this show up. It's called the Sherry Vine Variety Show. I mean, I did a variety show, it was like 7 years ago, called She's Living for This, which was
right on TV,
and it's now on Hulu.
So
people can watch that on Hulu. And this is just the next chapter of that. It's a variety show format also, and we tried to make it different. And I'm super excited. So I spent all summer writing, and then started pre-production September, October, and we filmed all of November.
Oh God.
Then we were editing. It's all done. I don't have the official air date, but it will be the end of May, so about 1 month from now.
Oh, it's soon. Great.
soon. It's going to be on Out. It's for Out TV. They have partnered with Apple. So it's going to be on Out TV. It's going to be on Apple Plus. If you're in the UK, it's on Fruit TV. And if you're somewhere that doesn't have any of those, you can watch it on Out TV's website or iTunes. It's going to be available anywhere you are. And amazing guests. I mean, Jackie Beat is in every episode. Bianca Del Rio is in every episode.
Funny.
Alaska, Bob the Drag Queen.
Fun.
Candace Kane, Tammy Brown, Monet Exchange, Alec Mappa, Mario Diaz, Nadia Ginsburg. I mean, just an amazing cast. Numbers, sketch comedy, silliness, just completely insane. And
I love
really
that.
Excited.
Oh, I'm excited. I can't wait.
So, you're doing all points bulletin to let people know. We had a really nice comment from, I'm probably not saying the name right, Jerky Parvanian.
Yep.
Did I not say, I don't know this person. Thank you for tuning in. The best things for several queens like Alaska, Trixie, and Katya has happened after the season. Like Trixie said, the real drag race starts after the season ends. Couldn't agree more. Mm-hmm. Well put.
So, well, yeah, that's when you have to have an, well, you have to have an act.
Right. You got to have a gimmick.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's, and again, that's what I mean by the craft. I think in some ways the craft has suffered because of the overexposure, but because it just, it used to be so raw and so real and so creative.
Yeah, the rawness. And,
well, Jackie, I'm sure it's Jackie who said it. Jackie's like, it's my job to keep drag dangerous.
Yes, yes, yes.
Well put.
Now, we mentioned the Golden Girlz. Tell us about the Golden Girlz.
We are allegedly doing it in July here in LA. It looks like it's going to really happen. We do it every year at Casita del Campo. We usually do it twice a year, and it's in the basement of a Mexican restaurant, which thankfully has survived. Many places have not.
Yeah, right? I know.
And so we can't have full capacity. So all the performers, the four of us, we're like, I don't care about the money. We just want to do it. Mm-hmm. And so I think we're going to do it for 3 weeks in July, fingers crossed, at Casita. I got a lot, hopefully, a lot going on.
You got a lot going on. And we want to talk about the merch. Very fine plan B. Okay. Nothing else, as she calls it in all her performances. I am modeling one of the Sherry Vine t-shirts, and you can tell them about the rest of the merch and where to get it.
Oh my God, that's so funny. I love that you remember that plan. I have no plan B. I have no other skills, so buy a shirt. That t-shirt, You're a Whore, is almost sold out. I've only got like 6 or 7 left, but I have a brand new one, which I don't have with me, which is stupid, but people can see it on the website. It's gorgeous, kind of David Bowie rock and roll design that this friend did. Anyway, new shirts. Your horse shirts. I've got eye mask pins. I've got, you can download all of my parodies on my website. Mm-hmm. There's a whole bunch of stuff. I got Sherry Vine, Your Whore mugs.
Oh, mugs. That's cool.
And it's all and it's all at sherryvine.com. You can find everything.
Personalized videos, whatever you want, it's going to be there. But honestly, people, people just really watch the new show, Share my variety show, then I'll be so happy.
Oh, we definitely will.
You let us know. We will make an all points bulletin about that. So I have to ask you this question. Our friend Ike Avelli, the amazing comedian, he always asks this question during an interview. Who's the worst person you ever performed with? I won't phrase it that way. I'll say, I know, because we don't want to throw anyone under the bus. Well, not today anyway. But what's one of the worst experiences that you had as a performer that sticks out in your mind?
There was, I think the worst, and I can say this because it's not even around, and it was at Splash. And
I loved Splash.
I'm at Splash too, and I don't know what it was about this one night. It just like everything that could go wrong. At first, I was out on stage singing live, and not one person was interested.
Oh.
I remember being up there, like starting to shake, like I was going to fall apart. I just wanted to run off the stage, and I didn't. That wasn't fun. But I haven't had, I mean, whatever. I just, you know, you got to turn. I've had things that started off shaky or rocky, and it's your job. Turn it around.
Right.
Stop this song in the middle. Stop. Let's try this other one that I know will be engage people or whatever. So, you know.
You just have to be able to do that. And sometimes, no matter what you do, you can't always win them over. Like, you're right, and Splash, I've had that doing stand-up. I don't like doing stand-up, though, I should say that. But what you learn as a performer, Tim, doing comedy like you do, sometimes they just don't freaking laugh. And you want to jump off that stage and beat the ever-loving hell out of them.
I wish we could in some shows.
Right?
We have one last question here, which is from Connie Pack T, which is Sherry Vine doing the Legend Cruise?
Ah.
No? Okay. Sorry. She asked. I didn't know.
No, you know what? That's fine. They're my, it's Varla, Jackie, Bunny, and Coco.
Okay.
And they are my absolute best friends.
Yeah.
And I'm nothing but happy for them. Good and I actually might go. Bianca and I were talking about going as guests.
Right.
And it's fine. And, you know, they did reach out to me to ask if I was interested. And I think I was number 5 on the list. Mm-hmm. So I don't mind being number 5 behind Varla, Coco, Bunny, and Jack.
We definitely consider you in that group. Well, once again, thank you. I cannot thank you enough. I just love and adore you.
I adore both of you. Anytime. I love you so much.
We feel the same.
And again, you're watching If These Walls Could Talk with your hosts, Wendy Stuart and Tim Moss, and our fabulous, wonderful guest, Sherry Vine, the one and only. And go to sherryvine.com to find out all things Sherry Vine.
And Sherry, right after this, just tell our audience the show that you're doing so they can tune into that if they want to as well.
Okay, honey. Oh, the one that's next?
Yeah, 3:00. Girl, I've got your schedule right here.
I'm doing Drag Chat with Betty Whitecastle. She's a queen in Pennsylvania who we met a couple years ago, and we've remained friends online, and she's hilarious, and I love her. So that's going to be on Instagram. You can go to my page on Miss Sherry Vine and find the link, blah, blah, blah.
At 3 p.m. here.
And Sherry, hang out for when the show's over. Tim and I always do a group photo.
Okay.
Yes. I just love and adore you, Sherry Vine. I cannot say enough about you.
Be fabulous. Be blonde. Be brazen. Be Sherry Vine.
Always. Yes.